won't be a famine of food, but of the word of Allah. Allah revealed in that day and time that Allah perfected religion, and in doing so completed his favor, and in all that guided us to al-Islam as deen, means chosen or preferred for us, and guided us to al-Islam. Allah revealed to the Prophet in this ayah, do not fear the disbelievers. Don't fear them. He says, fear me. It's not the same word as taqwa. It's a different word. But Allah says, don't fear the world. Don't fear them. Allah is more befitting to be feared. And if you fear whatever harm can come from them, you should be more worried about what Allah could do. So we should never be more worried about the people in the world. We should always be concerned more so about our relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's hitting that though. If you are forced to eat another spiritual food other than al-Islam, but are not inclined towards transgression, Allah is often forgiving and the most merciful of those who show mercy. People in their shortcomings and in their ignorance, they may eat something that they shouldn't be eating. In fact, this day and time, people don't know what to believe. They don't know what to think, what to feel. They're mixed up, and they certainly don't know what to eat. They can't tell you what's in whatever they're feeding off of. They get everything mixed up. Religion mixed up. Artificial religion. Likewise, much of the food is mixed up. Artificial food. If you want all natural food, you have to pay a steep price for it. You can get the food they want you to have, you can go there and get that real cheap. They call it junk food, some of it. Roadkill or something like that. You can get food like that, almost have to pay nothing for it. So Ramadan is asking us to deny ourselves food. But the food it's asking us to deny ourselves is the food of the world. Allah says, don't eat dead meat. Dead meat is meat that comes from the carcass of an animal that dies on its own. It just fell dead. It's what we call natural causes. In other words, it simply just dies. It was destined to die. It doesn't have eternal existence. It's supposed to die. Any ideology that's not in accord with the will of Allah will eventually die in of itself. In fact, anything we consume that is of that nature will die. So we don't eat it. Then it says the blood. You know, they drink wine to represent the blood. And the wine is intoxicating the body. It's putting the body in a drunken state. The blood is the life flowing through the veins. The blood cycles through the body and it gets dirty. It has to feed the body, but it also has to be purified. So we're not to eat the blood. Then it says the flesh of swine. What is the flesh of swine? Now actually that's number three in succession. First it said one thing, then it said another thing. Then it said the flesh of swine. In other words, if it's already dead, it's fell dead, you ain't supposed to eat that. If we see an animal and it's just dead, it's still haram. If it's a cow, if it's a lamb, no matter what it is, if it's dead and we find it's dead, we can't eat it. We can't halal that. And same way for the blood. You can't halal that. But the flesh of swine, even though that's number three, that's the number one on our mind. And so, we look at the appetites of the flesh, we have the tendency to satisfy those urges first, and in doing so, we neglect the first two. The flesh of swine is the filth, or the uncleanness, or the unfiltered things. Those things that have failed the test of time, like greed, selfishness, arrogance, racism, envy, gluttony, that which is amoral or immoral. They failed the test of time. It says, then, and that which has a name invoked on it other than that of Allah. It's speaking to the progression or consumption that leads to shirk. that lead to the overall regression and failure of human life and society. It mentions a few more meats that are forbidden, but if you follow where we're going, you know what we're talking about. The world and its leadership have created a vacuum, a shortage of food, not just the physical food, but also the food that nourishes the soul. They starve people to the point to where they're driven to eat just about anything. The religious missionaries, they go into countries where there's hunger, and they feed the people, and then afterwards they feed them religion. They feed them a shirt-type religion. They teach them that man is Allah. When people are hungry for physical food, and you provide it, then you can pose as Allah in the flesh, and people believe you because you came to them, and you appeared to them, and you appeared to save them. So they take the credit for what Allah has provided because they have mastered the environment that they are in while others haven't. Those who have, the have and the have nots, they call it. But those who have will become gods or the power or the authority over those who don't have. And when he has the support and the power, he oppresses those who won't accept that. He wages war and advances his power. Hasn't that been man's methodology? History bears witness to the man in power and his oppressive tendencies. We have a sign in the people, the food they're eating now. People eat what they've been duped into eating. Artificially preserved food, genetically altered food, farm-raised food, improperly slaughtered food. Some of it is worse than swine. What is it all leading to again? Shirt. And if you do enough minor shirt, then eventually you'll get to the major shirt. So Allah says, in that day, but in this day, those who disbelieve, that's those whose belief was or is misplaced. They're not people who believe. They're people who are in opposition to faith. They say they're only accountable to themselves and what they want to promote. Allah says, they have given up hope of your deen, and so don't fear them. And he's perfected our way of life for us. The Muslim way of life is the perfected way of life. Our way of life is not happenstance. It's perfect. If we follow it, if we accept it, if we live it the way it's supposed to be lived, it's a perfect way of life. We don't have to concern ourselves about what kind of life other people are living when we live in the life we're supposed to be living. Our deen is deen al-fitra, or the way after nature, pattern after nature itself. During Ramadan, every day we have iftar at sunset. Sunset is when the natural light that exposes the world is gone. There's no more physical light, or we say the physical light is going away. It's becoming dark. It's not dark already, but it's getting dark. We see the darkness coming. It's not coming all of a sudden. While we see it coming, we do two things. We eat something. You know, when the fast time comes to break, we take a little something. A little something to sustain us. And then we offer a Salat al-Maghrib. Once we do that, then we eat the food that has been prepared for us to nourish us when the light is going out. The light, this light is the light we call revelation. Food that is prepared to nourish us in times when there is famine in the world. And we can look at the world and it's a famine in the world. The world is bankrupt almost when it comes to knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and adhering to those things that we claim we believe that Allah asks of us to do. That Allah doesn't force us to do, but Allah asks of us to do for the benefit of our own souls. So this food that we're eating is prepared to nourish us in times where there's a famine in the world. And the word of Allah and the guidance of Allah and the light of Allah that we have is the light that rewrites the world so that we have our life in the light while the world We turn the light back on with the month of Ramadan. Every day, that iftar. It's coming from the same word that fitra comes from, meaning we go back to the natural form or the natural way. Today, people are going back to natural foods, natural medicine. While we have modern food and modern medicine, we still don't want to lose our connection with what's natural. So the table gets set, and we bring food to the table. We have a saying, what are you bringing to the table? It means, what are your qualifications? What benefit comes with you? If you don't bring anything to the table, or to what our effort is all about, then your usefulness is limited, or may be of no value at all. So Muslims and believers believe in Allah wholeheartedly, and be sincere in that belief. Have sincere intentions in whatever actions we take, and we mean well. We do what we feel and what we believe, what we know to be right. We become assets as opposed to liabilities in everything that we do. We don't burden others with our rhetoric or with our desires. We're a part of the solution as opposed to a part of the problem. And when you're comfortable with those things, then you're living the righteous life, you're living the Muslim life. As Muslims, we bring to the table that which is essential for Muslim life and the advancement of human life and society. Our Prophet, Allah's messenger, he represents Allah as a sign to us. He's a sign in that Allah says that he's a mercy to all humanity. Rahmatan lil alameen. He's a mercy to all of the world. We, that is the Muslims, we bring the best to all the systems of the world of man. Allah guides Prophet Muhammad to say, to tell us, he says, "Qul ana basharun mithlukum," to tell the people that I'm a mortal, that I'm a human being, just like you. He's just like we are. You know, when I was putting this talk together, I was drinking some coffee, and I got cold, I zapped it in the microwave. And so when I got it out, I took a sip, it was too hot, I had to spit it out. And it was spontaneous. That microwave made it so hot I couldn't take it. And I said to myself, well, that's how it's supposed to be when something in our life gets too hot to handle. We're supposed to get rid of it immediately. Spit it right out. I didn't care if it went all over the computer, the desk, anywhere. It just had to get out off around me. It had to get out of me. I didn't care where it went other than that. Just to get out of my mouth. Just too much. Now, it might not be something so obvious as something too hot. It might not be the flesh of swine. It might be cold. It might just be dead meat or blood. You know, you cook something so rare, it still has blood in it. The good food, the best food, may not be available, and you may see your life slipping away. However, you need to get some nourishment. Now, you can take it if you want. If your heart is right and your intent is right, you can't find any other food, you can take it. You know, if you're being driven out of your mind, like an animal driven out of his mind when he has to eat something. When he's hungry, you know, an animal, when he's hungry, he eat anything. But during Ramadan, the table is spread with the good things that Allah created, the natural life that Allah created. And we're brought back to that life, the life of natural submission, the life of a Muslim. We have in the seerah of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam a message in Bilal for us. Bilal is introduced to us in our Islam in the context of Tawheed. And as a result, he quickly developed a profound taqwa. His taqwa was so profound that he was ready to die as opposed to accepting to be a slave to anything other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If the hadith says that Bilal will enter the Jannah in front of the Prophet. We recently had a popular person mention that slavery was a choice. For some, it's a choice. For others, it's a condition. And others, it's oppression. And not everyone is looking to die. And everyone will see and examine his life differently. Some don't mind moving on from this life at any time. Some will say, come on, I'm ready to go. I'm ready to die for what I believe in. And some are not. We can't judge that. It's different for different people. So not everything is a choice for some people in their mind's eye. Ramadan gives us the power of choice, but the power of choice Ramadan gives us is the power to choose Allah. In the hadith, it says, as reported to in the hadith, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, at the time of Fajr prayer, the Prophet asked Bilal, tell me the best deed you did after embracing al-Islam, for I heard your footsteps in front of me in paradise. Bilal said, I didn't do anything worth mentioning, except that whenever I performed ablution, during the day or night, I prayed after that ablution, or as much as was written for me. He mentioned basically that he made wudu and prayed as much as he could. Bilal is the muezzin, the one who calls to the prayer, calls to life, the cultivation of life, that life being the Muslim life. Bilal is given to us in this way. He's not mentioned as a Sahaba that much, even though he was a Sahaba. He was one of the first to accept the faith. But his role is not emphasized like some of the others. But he was willing to die as opposed to commit shirk. And later he was chosen to call the Muslims to prayer. So in the hadith, we find it mentioned that his footsteps was heard. It didn't say he saw it. It said he heard his footsteps. Now, to recognize someone's footsteps means you really have to be close to him. He just heard his footsteps, so he was saying he knows his behavior. He knows his character. That's how close they were. Now, the foot is the last thing you want to move. That's the feet. The feet carry the load the body places on. They carry us from place to place. They are support for the body. They come at the end of wudu. After all the rest of the body is clean, we have to keep the support clean. The feet nowadays have covering. And we have socks and shoes. Back then, they had socks. What you heard mostly were socks. Now, they didn't have shoes, but the emphasis of that day, was on the socks. And socks is the initial covering, or the primary covering in the time we have today. But we have stronger covers now, shoes. We hardly ever wear shoes, though, without socks, unless it's a sandal. And sandals are usually open, and the foot is exposed, and the part of the foot that makes contact is protected. The parts covered are called the toes, the ball, the sole, and the heel. They're the four parts of the bottom of the foot. Now the wudu, if you keep your foot covered during the day, if you make your wudu over, that means if you break your wudu, then all you have to do when you make wudu is wipe the top of the feet. So Prophet Muhammad reported that he said he heard Bilal's footsteps in front of him. He meant that in recognizing his behavior and his characteristics, and he asking what was the best deed he did after embracing al-Islam. That's the operative question. He embraced al-Islam. That's the key statement in the hadith. You have to embrace Islam. This is what's going on with the Muslims in society. The failure to embrace Islam, to embrace it, to hold it, to have it, to hug it. He said, he didn't give any profound answer. No way all activity was done. He simply made wudu, he purified himself, then he offered his prayer, and he asked what's written for him? What's written for him? What's written for Adam? What's written for all the other prophets? What's written for the believers? What's written is Jannah, the paradise. And if all the requirements are met, what's written is the garden of paradise for us. So he purified himself and he prayed. He established his prayers. We pray five times every day, but sometimes we don't pray. Sometimes we get the impression that five times prayer every day is very difficult. But if anything that we really don't want to do is hard to do. And if you really want to do it, it becomes very easy to do. If you want to do it. So he was saying, I just did what I normally, what I naturally do. I didn't do anything special. So Bilal was saying, you can have the world, and I'll die before I feed off anything that takes me away from Tawheed. Allah says you can. Allah says I can. But I'd rather die, I'd rather be with Allah than the oppressive nature of people in the world who disbelieve. So Ramadan, it comes and it brings back the mind, the right behavior, it brings back the proper thinking, and it turns the light on for all of us. It is the light of Allah that gets turned on for us. And the light of Allah, we said, is His revelation. In the month of Ramadan, we have a tradition of reading the Quran. We're in about the 24th or 25th day. So we should be almost finished reading the Quran. Very few religious people have a tradition of reading their scripture every year and completing it. Most people in religion haven't even read their religious books. They don't know what it says. They have to depend on somebody across the pulpit to tell them. And you don't know what they're telling them sometimes. They don't even know what they're telling them sometimes. So it's the light of Allah, and Allah says that He revealed it to bring you out of the depths of darkness and into the light of understanding. Alhamdulillah, you are God in me. So the parts of the body that are affected the most with this message is the brain. The brain, the heart of the brain. The heart and the brain are aspects of the soul. Allah turns the light on in the soul, and once Allah turns the light in the soul on, then Allah turns the light on in the brain or the mind. And when the brain is turned on, when the intellect of man is turned on, he has the greatest opportunity to secure his life, and in securing his life, by the grace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he secures his destiny. He secures his future. He secures that which is to come. And what is to come from the life that we're living is the perfect life that comes after this life. The life that we're living on this earth as Muslims, when we leave this life, hopefully again, we leave it better than we found it. We should have left it better than we found it because we were babies when we found it. So now that we're adults or we're growing, something when we leave here, no matter when we leave here, the situation, our circumstances, and the things around us, the things that are associated by us or with us, they should all be in a better situation than they were when we first encountered them. Alhamdulillah, bismillah, amen.
Alhamdulillah. Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen. لا إله إلا الله محمد رسول الله. So to continue, I don't know how much time y'all have. I don't have a whole lot to say. And then again, I do have a whole lot to say. But I try to be brief. And I haven't been here to Masjid Wadi Muhammad in a very long time. It's been at least a decade since I was here. But there was a time when we came here just about every week from Toledo, where I'm from. And it's still the same. Alhamdulillah, still the same. It's still here. And it's a sign that, you know, we're doing what we're supposed to be doing. We're doing what we're supposed to be doing. Because some things fall by the wayside. They don't last, they don't stand the test of time. But if you have faith and you believe in what you're doing, you strive to do the right thing, then alhamdulillah, Allah bless us, you know, to have the security and have the longevity that we're looking for, especially in those things that we're trying to do to benefit ourselves and benefit our community. So to go on, Allah, He mentions in the Quran that Allah is the light of the heavens and the earth. From the Surah An-Nur. says, in the parable of the light, it's as if it were a niche and within it a lamp, and the lamp enclosed in glass, the glass as if it were a bright star lit from a blessed tree, an olive, neither of the east nor of the west, whose oil is well nigh luminous, though fire scarce touch it. Light upon light, Allah doth guide whom he will to his light. Allah does set forth parables for men, and Allah does know all things. And in this surah, you know, the way surahs are put together, it always fascinates me. Because the surah is the title of the light. But when you open it, it starts speaking immediately to the subject of adultery and fornication. It starts speaking to illegal sexual activity, intercourse. And intercourse is when we engage something or someone. Any, you know, intercourse is not just sexual intercourse. It's when you engage something. We call it intercourse. So now, back to what we're bringing to the table. What are we bringing to the table as individuals? If we're feeding off the right thing, off the halal things, and I'm going to digress just a little bit. This surah, though, and nur, the light. See, when the behavior is not right, the light is off. There's no light in the life of a human being when his behavior is not in check. In other words, he's like an animal. And animals are ignorant. They're instinctive. They run around, their whole life is dark. The human being, like his life is lit up. But his life is only lit up when his behavior is where it's supposed to be, when he behaves like a human being. If he doesn't behave like a human being, then his light will always be off. He'll always be running around in the dark like an animal. So we ask, what are we bringing to the table? If we're feeding off the right things, if the halal things, then those things that we bring to the table, they support the life that we're supposed to be living. They carry the life, and they perpetuate the life, and they keep us focused on the best future for human life. This is what Ramadan prepares for us and guides us to, the best human life possible. In Surah Nur, we mentioned it starts out with behavior, how we engage each other, how we act towards each other, relationship between the male and the female, and also the relationship between the heart and the mind, that which is halal and haram, is speaking to behavior and characteristics. It goes on to address the subject of slander, and in case you accuse someone of improper behavior, improper intercourse, you have to have witnesses. It means that before you start trying to address issues where there's deviation from the proper and natural course of life in human society, we have to make sure we know what we're talking about and what we're doing. Not just what we think, not just what we see, but we have to have witnesses also. And they're affected by this activity. Now, we all catch a married person in legal sexual activity, then they're trying to be caught. They want to be caught. Or it's out in the open, it's blatant. And if we know a thing like that, then if it's witnesses to it, then they have an obligation to bring it to light. But it doesn't have to be sex. It can be any haram activity that's affecting the proper course of life in society. And they are to be punished if they're leveling false accusations and slander. If you're doing that, you're supposed to be punished. And it's addressing it in this manner because matters that put the light out in society, and by allowing our light to be put out in our individual lives and our personal lives, then we are impacting the community life. So we want to keep the lights on in our life and in our community life. When the light is out, Ramadan comes and it gives us another light. Actually, for some, it's the initial light or additional light. The light is turned on when we behave correctly, as we mentioned. When our behavior matches the behavior of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when the behavior is right, the mind is right. And when the mind is right, the world is lit up the way Allah wants the world to be lit up. So then we see later in that surah where Allah says, Allah is the light of the heavens and the earth. Whether it's our spiritual life or our material life, Allah is the light of both of them. We don't have, as Muslims, we don't have a separate life, a secular life and a sacred life. We live a complete life, a total life. So now we started off with Surah Maidah. And in concluding this surah, you know, it speaks to the prophet Isa. You know, and I tell people, I said that the story around Jesus is the biggest problem in the world. I call it the Jesus syndrome. It's the biggest problem in the world. We started off with Surah Maidah, and in concluding this surah, Jesus is asked by his disciples for a table spread. They ask the question, can your Lord send down for us from the skies, from the heavens? Jesus responded, have taqwa if you're a believer. Now this isn't the Bible, this is the Quran. They said, we want to eat from it so our hearts can know, can be reassured he came with the truth. And he is the witness himself to the truth. So Jesus prayed to Allah for what they asked. And this is the only time the word eat is mentioned in the Quran. He asked for the table, this table spread, and eat to represent the beginning and the end. He says, the first of us and the last of us. Maidah is coming from the root, mean, yah, and dal. It means to be shaken or to be moved, agitated, to spread. It speaks to a commotion. And the word in the surah is ma'idatan, like tame, too. The table with food on it. It's not just a table, but it's a table with food on it. And it's also speaking to the table that has the food we call knowledge upon it, because knowledge is the spiritual food. So this table spread, he says, it brings this is the kind of food that brings life to the soul, to the spiritual life. And Allah says, okay, I'll do it, but if you reject it after that, I will inflict upon you a punishment like no other. Yeah. In other words, you want it? I'm going to give it to you. But if you don't have the faith that you're supposed to have after you get this directive, then you will be punished with something that I haven't inflicted on no other people before. No other person. Who is this Jesus? Jesus is the word of Allah that contains the spirit. Not the Jesus in the Bible, rather Isa, the prophet and messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Some people say they have the word of Allah, but it's lost its spirit because they're not living it. They're not living by it. The religious world stopped living by the word of Allah. They stopped living the pure words. You know, when it comes to being pure, that takes on a whole different connotation. And Allah says about this month of Ramadan, says it's not that Allah's desires of making it difficult for us. Allah wants for us to be pure. This is what Allah, the objective is to purify ourselves, to get ourselves to the point to where we're pure enough to look at what Allah has revealed. Because again, you read the Quran every day. You should be reading the Quran every day. And if you read the Quran every day, you want to be blessed with an understanding of that word. You want to be able to look into it. You want to be able to decipher. You want to be able to understand what Allah wants you to know. The Quran has everything in it that Allah wants the human being to know. And if Allah didn't want us to know it, it wouldn't be in there. If Allah didn't want us to understand it, it wouldn't have been real. So it's for us to understand. And it's for us to incorporate into our psyche so that we can be people who understand, who appreciate, who love the word of Allah so much that it mushrooms over into the very life that we're living in our everyday life, as well as our life in society, our life in the community and society. So he tells them, if you don't take this, I'm gonna punish you like no one ever been punished before. That's a strong statement. That's saying, look, you better, you got this Quran. You got the word of Allah, the unadulterated word of Allah. And we say the Quran is what? It is a completion and a correction. correction for that which came before it. So it's perfect. And he says what? He says, this day and that day. But in this day, I have completed my favor upon you. I have chosen for you Al Islam as your deen. He's made it, it's perfect. It's perfected. There's nothing wrong with it. And again, going back to the, even just to the way the Quran is choreographed. You know, the first surah of the Quran is Al-Fatiha. But that's not the first surah that was revealed to Prophet Muhammad. That wasn't the first one. So it's put together in a precise way. It's put together in a way to reach out at you. And then as soon as you recite Al-Fatiha, it says, this is the book. This is the book that there is no doubt in it. And it is a guide for those who have taqwa, those whose hearts are connected to God. Yes. It comes right out the box telling you what this is. This is that book. Not any other book, but this book. This is that book. There's no doubt in it. It's perfect. And it is a guide for those who love God, who love Allah. So we have the table is spread for us. It's laid out for us. We got all this food on the table. All this spiritual food is full. The table is running off of the table all over the place. It's everywhere. All these ayahs, all these surahs, all these ayahs, they're all over the place. All the whole table full of them. All we have to do is look at them, take them, digest them, and use them like they're supposed to be used. That's what we, the Muslims, you bring to the table, especially you that are descendants of our ancestor Bilal. The one who would rather die, I'd rather kill me before I commit shirk. I'd rather leave up out of here, take me up out of here before I deny God. Now you can do it. Now if you force, says you can drink, you can eat the dead meat, you can drink the blood, you can have. If you force out of necessity and it's not in your desire in your heart to do it, you can do it. But Bilal said, "No, I ain't doing it. I'd rather be dead than deny my Lord." So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed us in this day and time with the Quran and his perfect example left in the life of Muhammad the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He left us with the Quran for all time to the end of the world. And again, as a blessed people, a people that are blessed to be encouraged to. Now, you don't have to read it, but be encouraged to read it in its entirety. At least once a year, so that you always be familiar with what Allah wants the human being to know. Yeah, so you always be familiar with that. So we thank Allah forever for always for blessing us, for being alive, for being well, for being in good spirits. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala ali Muhammad. Kama sallaita ala Ibrahim wa ala ali Ibrahim. وبارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد آمين.
الله أكبر. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله. أشهد أن محمد رسول الله هيا على الصلاة هيا على الفلاح قد قامت الصلاة قد قامت الصلاة الله أكبر الله أكبر لا إله إلا الله.
Yeah.
We'd like to thank Imam Ibrahim. Yes, sir, for that wonderful goodbye today. Man, let me just, I don't know what to say. Allahu Akbar. There's a couple other things that we'd like to mention.